It was obviously a timber company. Cloutier was most likely the type of boss to never be around, a faceless name, so to speak. It served as a reminder that the big boss, William Hamilton, had been killed. It was a typical shack, just like the ones you hear about in Quebecois legends. Local lumberjacks used it to rest and twice a day heat up their pea soup. Who quits a game one step away from victory? The leftover food, the clothes, the general warmth of the place, no evidence of escape. Carl was sure of it. People were here not long ago, and they expected to come back. Thank you. Someone had been playing with a crossbow here. A very dangerous game. A bolt could hit someone's tire, or their eye. It could even kill someone if the aim was right. Without a single window to brighten things up, the inside of the cabin was almost pitch black. Beware of close encounters of knee and furniture. Solitaire, a card game only hermits can truly enjoy. Carl felt depressed at the thought of playing this. A wintry atmosphere surrounded the house. The soundlessness of the area suggested it was empty. When finding a boot, one wonders what became of the foot. The key, which seemed to be meant for a padlock, bore an inscription reading Klutze Efes. A company name. Better keep an eye open. Businesses weren't exactly numerous around these parts. The Spirograph amused Carl. It was a nice modern toy. Aside from being repetitive by nature and completely useless, still, it found its way into many Quebecois homes. A pay stub for some undoubtedly harsh lumberjack work. Alexandre Blais felled trees and chopped woods for Cloutier et Fils. Money in a jar. What a shame. Carl would have loved cookies. Money in a jar. What a shame. Carl would have loved cookies. The picture had been taken inside the house. It was the same wallpaper. Judging by the smiles, nobody suspected the impending misfortunes. Little Martin Blais with a family member. There was some resemblance between them, and Carl took note of the sense of bonding and pride they projected. Well, looks like someone woke up on the wrong side of the bed. Thank you. The coals were still warm. Someone must have been stirring them up. A window left open in that weather? Perhaps something had to be watched. The sheets were in such a way that indicated a rude awakening, followed by a hurried escape. What had happened here?
Thank you.
key. What could it be for? The garden shed? Carl couldn't reach it with his arm alone, but he had more than a few tricks up his sleeve to pick it up. The track was fresh. That meant the car sunk down just a little while ago. Now where the hell could the passengers possibly have gone? The crossbow bolts had the same origin. Carl was sure of it. Who was it? And more importantly, what was being hunted like this? There was only void where the road should be. Carl hated dead ends. He felt trapped. It was as if the road had drowned in the lake. He would have to find help by another road. Someone must have dropped this in a hurry, but whoever did was heading into the woods. Carl's tracking instincts were quickly kicking in. In spite of Dr. Beaupre's goodwill, the place didn't look much like a physician's office. It could easily be mistaken for a sewing shop. There should be a law forbidding doctors from falling sick. For the one-eyed, or for other vision problems, the eye patch was the way to go. Carl got the trembles as he imagined the excruciating pain that kind of scalpel could no doubt inflict. Within these miserable walls, patients probably felt more like in a slaughterhouse than in a doctor's office. The good doctor, flanked by his beautiful spouse. Pure happiness. Captured on cardstock. Carl recognized this woman's soulful eyes. Was it Dr. Beaupre, who had hit him head-on at the village border? Doctors used light-reflecting frontal mirrors to look inside the patient's cavities. That was a bit unsettling, but back then, it was pretty much always the case with medicine. There was no doubt that the doctor and Hamilton knew each other very well. Someone had lost a few liters of blood here. Carl's first thought had been a lumber accident, someone's hand cut by a saw, or a hunting accident. In any case, whoever had lost all this blood couldn't have gone far. Perhaps they were already dead. A communist manifesto. Only a few years ago, this type of allegiance meant prison time. And even at present, the Western world was very wary of the Soviet threat. Why would the doctor own such a book? Nobody kills a rich patient to start a revolution. It didn't make any sense. He had to dig deeper still to understand. Luckily, that was Carl Faubert's specialty. Dr. Dr. Beaupré had done his medical studies quite far from here. He was surely one of the first students out of the new campus to settle on the mountainside. A chamber pot. Fortunately for Carl, inspecting it wouldn't further this particular investigation. The injured could be recognized by the large stains of red, an informal nickname given to Merbroman, smudged all over their injuries.